All right. So defining attributes, right? So class has attributes and methods. The attributes are basically variables within a class. Let's create a class called vehicle, and that's good. So we're going to create these classes and objects, and then we'll do kind of a real life scenario that we do for creating a users or something, right? And then you guys will have some classwork today, and then after the classwork, we'll review the classwork together, and then I'll assign you some homeworks, right? And that should clear out some of the classes and object conceptually. All right, so let's do this one. So this is what you gotta really understand: defining attributes, a class's attributes and methods. We already know what the methods are, right? We just talked about it. And then attributes are, they just basically means variables, right? But what type of variables? It's not defining it here. It's field variables, right? So the field variable has a scope which can be used across entire class, right? So that's what we're going to do right now. So let's create this class. I'll create a new package probably here. Right, so right, so this is the class name would be what? Vehicle in this case. We are trying to create kind of like a think of like a template for vehicle, right? So every time I need to create a vehicle, I have to create a class. Think about this, like every time you have to insert something into the console, you have to call what? Scanner. So scanner is sort of the template, but you can use a scanner to insert any data from any, all of you guys can insert different set of data. We're not stopping you there, but if you wanted to insert something into a console, you had to use the template from scanner. Make sense? So we're going to do the same thing. If you want to build a vehicle, you have to use the template. I don't want to keep saying template, class vehicle, right? So that's the proper term. All right, so let's do this. All right, so that's your class name. So we have a vehicle, but what makes vehicle, right? So there are a few things we can do. You can say, well, vehicle can have, and we can go all day about this. So something like vehicle would require, like hundreds of classes to make a vehicle, right? But for this case, let's just keep it simple. Let's say our vehicle has something called max speed, but every vehicle will be different, so we're not gonna be hard coding anything. So hard coding means I am not setting the value here. I'm not saying that max speed equals to 100 or something like this, right? So we'll just leave that empty, and then vehicle can have wheels, right? And then also it can have color, and also it can have city. And then finally, so these are your attributes. This is kind of what vehicle not necessarily must have, right? This is the data point of these vehicles, and you have to have a variable that stores those, right? But then you have a behavior, and that's when you have to build methods. This will probably look good. So that's pretty much what they want us to say. So what they're saying is max speed, wheels, color, and fuel capacity are attributes of our vehicle class, and horn is our only method. So next step is, well, I get that we created this, but how do we actually use it, right? So right now, as you can see, vehicle has not been called, it's never been used. You see, when you get this, I guess, info bar, that means, you know, it's you have it, but no one ever used it. So whenever you go into a company, you're never going to see a class that is never used, because it makes no sense, right? Everything is going to refer to something. So let's create, I'll just create something called app, right? And we'll split this. You don't have to split it, but this is easier to kind of see what's going on, right? And they want us to create this vehicle. We'll delete this. So, but you see, there's no main method here because we are never going to run our code here. Does that make sense? We are never going to execute our code here. What we have to do is we still need a main method to run our code. So think of this is your front-end application or something like that, right? This is something that you're using a browser. So I like to see this as like a browser. If you had a browser and if you hit a button called create vehicle, right, it's kind of creating it behind the scene, and then you're setting a color and printing the color. So this is kind of our execution point. So you still always need a main method to run your code. This is, again, a template, and you don't see any main method here. So what we want to do is create a vehicle. So we'll say, and you see now you have that available, and it's telling you which package has it. And we just created a package called classes and objects, and then we have it there. So let's say vehicle, and then we'll call it a V1 equals to new vehicle, right? And then what they're doing is they're creating two different objects of vehicle. So let's say vehicle V2 equals to new vehicle. So even though they're both vehicle, but now they're kind of their own storage, right? So what we can say is, hey, V1 dot color equals to red. So we set for V1, we set the color to
red,
right? So now it's kind of his own identity, right? So V1 has his own attributes, right? The data points is gonna be different. Wheels could be 4, and the other one could have, I don't know, 12, maybe it's a big truck, right? So what I'm trying to explain it to you here is this is not the way we're gonna end up working. We're gonna do a much more efficient way. But even though they're just templates, every time you need to build a vehicle, we'll get it. But then we can configure it however we want it, right? But vehicle controls what is necessity for vehicle, right? So whatever attributes that is necessity for vehicle will always insert it here. And then everyone who created a vehicle, they will be kind of forced to or have an option to update to the new attributes that we've added into our, kind of like a new versioning, right? But you have to control it at a central point, and this is kind of what our object is. Does that make sense? Right? So now if we say V1 dot on, right? And if we run this, you get a beep, right? I mean, we don't have anything to print color, so that's fine. But let's see what. So this is kind of what we're saying is we can create a multiple object of your class and use the dot syntax to access their attributes and methods. And we already know that. The way you access their attributes and methods is by dot. But you see how we are accessing these methods? That's very bad approach, right? I mean, not methods, sorry. Attributes, like the field variables. You know, I'll highly recommend not to do that, and we are not going to do that. But you, if you don't have, remember we used to have these private access modifiers, right? And that's what we're going to be learning here, right? So in this case, if you don't have, let's say, private, and if you have either public or you don't have anything in front, what that means is you can access these variables from anywhere. As soon as you create an object, you can access them, right? And that's not the goal here. What we really want to do is only access method from class, and the methods can only access your variables, right? That way you trap your data points very securely. No one can access your data without going through your methods. And you can put logic in your methods, but you cannot put a logic on your data points, right? So you have more control over your methods, even though they are also accessing your data, but they can only access it within the house, all right? So just what you really want to take away is that this is how we create an object, right? But the attributes and the method has to have some relation with, you know, this, you know, like now I can't put something like, oh, shoes or something like this. That there's no relationship between shoes and vehicle. Maybe there might be some weird relationship between them. Like, oh, you have a passenger who wears the shoes, but that is not directly related to vehicle. In that case, you will have another object called passenger, right? And that passenger can have, you know, like a tire or whatever. Like, it can go into crazy mind, right? But then passenger could be part of a vehicle, like how many passengers and stuff. But the whole idea of shoes. So make sure whenever you decide your attributes, it makes sense. It belongs. There has a relationship. This object, these attributes, and this behavior or methods represents this vehicle, right? So that's how you have to think about it. So we create an object, I mean class, with attributes and methods, and then we call them or instantiate them in this manner, right? And you can access your attributes. If they are not private, you can access them and set the value, like the way we've done it here. And then obviously, you should be able to call your methods as well, all right? So that leads to the second, and this one is not too complex. It's very easy, and we should be finishing this in 5 minutes. So now let's discuss the public keyword in front of the main method, right? So we've been seeing public for a while, right? And I promised we're gonna learn it eventually. So public static void main. So public is an access modifier. So these are all access modifier: public, protected, private, and the default one. So public is an access modifier, meaning that is used to set the level of access. You can use the access modifier for classes, attributes, and methods, right? So we can have a class that is private. We can have a method that is private or public, right? Most of the time these are public. You can obviously have an attribute that is also, the access modifier can go in front of any of those things. Methods, attributes, classes. So for classes, the available modifier are public or default left blank, as described below. So public, the class is accessible by any other class, right? Default, the class is accessible only by classes in the same package. So we can ignore that today because we're not gonna be making private or public. All our classes is going to be public. So don't worry about that. The following choices are available for attributes and methods. So attributes means variables, right? And when I say variable, I mean field variables, right? So default, a variable or a method declared with no access control modifier is available any other class in the same package. So what that means is, what they're saying is, let's say we did not provide this, right? It's still a method, it's still a valid method, but I can only access between those two classes. What they're saying is you can only access them within the package, Make sense? So if I try to access them from basics, it won't work. All right? So that's kind of what protected means. I don't like to build default ones without it. I actually like to, if that's what you want, just use the word protected, right? Because that's what protected means as well. So protected or default means you can only access your variables or method within the same package. That's it. It's that simple. And then you have public accessible from any other class. So public is the most accessible one. So like, let's say if this was public, so now I can access them anywhere. I can, if I create an object inside of a basics, I will have access to Horn, right? If I created object, obviously we did it here in vehicle inside of another class within the same package, that's also accessible. So public is, you know, obviously the most accessible one. So this is again that we just talked about. Protected mean provides the same access level as the default class modifier. So default one is if you don't specify anything. By default, is protected. So protected means you can only access this within the same package, right? There are some other details here. I don't want to go over that right now because that's going to confuse you a little bit. But for now, we're not going to go into... once we get to inheritance, we can talk about this. Private, accessible only within the declared class itself. So when we think of private, which is the most common one, right? So let's say we have private. Let's make this private. And you see how you got that error here now? Right, so I don't have access to that anymore. The only way I can access it through another method. And we didn't learn that yet, but we're gonna learn how to do that. So that's kind of what you do with attributes. All your field variable, in theory, should be private, right? And then if you wanted to set some sort of color, then you know we can do that. We gotta create a method that sets the color for us, right? That's called getter and setter. We'll get there in a little bit. But for now, let's say if we made this private, no one can access this. Now you have an error here as well. It's just saying, hey, Horn has a private access in class object vehicle, right? So private means you can have a method that only the purpose is to maybe help another method within the same class. But I don't want to expose this. I don't want to expose this to another classes. Now, I have junior engineers asking me, like, what do I have to do? Why don't I just make everything public, right? So I was like, okay, why don't you just open all the door in your house, right? So it doesn't work that way. You need to protect certain things, right? Certain things needs to be in certain places. You also need to understand that, well, you know, what is this purpose of this method? Is this purpose is to be exposed everywhere? If that's the case, then you will make it exposable by using public. But then even then, you have to ask yourself, is this method going to be exposed beyond this package, right? That's great engineering, because now you're thinking. You're not just copy-pasting and making it public, private, based on your requirement. And requirement is going to be different for all of you guys, depending on your industry, right? So you're going to ask that, okay, hey, is this method going to be exposed beyond this package? If the answer is yes, make it public. If it's going to be, because that also gives information to other engineers who's going to work on this project. When they see this is protected, they already know that, hey, the purpose of this was to stay within this package. Maybe there is a reason for that, right? And private means we are not going to take this method or these attributes outside of this class. So whatever we have to do, we can use it within the class. And if I need to expose it, maybe I need to create another method and expose it. But there's a reason they decided not to do that. So all of these has some hidden message. You can't put a comment on every little things, right? That's not coding. That's right, just putting comments all over that. So make sure there is a reason for all of this, and don't just put things. I mean, in our case, we're going to do a lot of practicing. So it's fine. Most of the time, you're just going to use private and public. We don't use protected a lot, but you know, you need to understand where, when to use protected. I don't like to use default, like something like this, because it throws a confusion for me. I don't know if you forget to put access modifier here, or you know, you're using it for protected. I should not have to think about that, right? We have an option. If you want to make it protected, just use the word. I mean, it's not a big deal, right? You're not saving a lot of keys here. So just kind of make sure you understand what you're doing. Every time you do something, ask yourself, why am I doing this, right? And that kind of, you know, clarifies a lot of things.
So what's the difference between protected and private? The protected you can use only for methods, or private?
No, you can use protected for.
So what's the difference? Why we can use only private instead of?
You can use anything you want, but the key, what you're missing is, I don't want you to use this thing directly. The reason for that is, we don't want to make it. You see how people are use easy to be able to set this color red, right? So now, every time someone creates a vehicle, they have access to your data points. That's not good. We need to encapsulate that. We need to put a kind of a wrapper around that, right? So if you're going to access my data point, you have to go through some logic, maybe, right? Is your data correct? What you're trying to access, is this what you're looking for, right? So usually the attribute points or the field variables, it has to be private. You know, it's not must. There are places you're going to see that it's public or whatnot, but most of the time, I like to have these things as private, all right? So that we are protecting them, and no one can access that, because this is what all the logics are going to be around those. These are your behaviors, but, you know, you can behave certain way, but if you don't have hands, all right, I know, it's going to be very hard to do certain things. So these are going to be your data points, and we are going to be protecting our data points by using private. But your question could be like, hey, well, how do I access it? If you're going to make it private, how can I set colors now? Well, we'll figure that out in the next chapter, right? Look, they're already saying it here, right? It's a best practice to keep the variables within a class private. The variables are accessible and modify using getters and setters, right? To set continued. So what they're saying the same thing is that you have to make them. I mean, it's a good standard. You don't have to, right? But then you're making more chaos for yourself, right? So a lot of the coding standards, guys, like I don't enforce it as much, but these are the standard at Google or Facebook, right? So when you go into certain libraries, like certain company, you're not going to see a lot of clean code, right? So when you get out of here, you're at the end product. We're not there yet about like coding standards. The end product, your script's going to look really nice. It's like reading an English paragraph, right? We're going to get to that point, but this standard, it's not like you go to Verizon. It's not going to be like this, right? So I just want you to kind of have low expectation when you go to the job, right? Because you're learning, and think of like you're working at a Facebook or something, okay? So that's based off my experience is what you're learning here. So the last end product is going to be much cleaner when you see your code base. Anyone should be able to read your code, right? You don't write a code to make it complex so your job security stays longer, right? That's not the goal. Make you a bad engineer. So make sure anyone should be able to read the code and understand what's going on without any comments, right? Putting too many comments, it's not good. So here I have some, you know, there's some images here to tell you. So public means class can access it, package can access it. If there's a subclass, that can access it. And obviously global, everyone can access it. Protected, same thing, subclass can access it. We didn't talk about subclass yet. When we get to inheritance, we'll talk about subclasses. Default, again, private, the mostly you're going to see public and private. All right, those two you can ignore for now. All right, any questions on access modifiers? What's up? Yeah.
So you want all the data for private, can you change public for the first one for private?
Which one?
For the public class. If I change it to private, that's enough for all data is private?
Oh, no, that's a good wish, but that's... I know what you're saying. I'm just messing with you. No, you can make your class private. So what happens is, what we can do is, and it's a little bit advanced for this class, we're not gonna cover this. Right. We can make your class private, right? But it cannot be accessed outside of, so a lot of time we create private classes to support the public class within the same file. Right. But no, you cannot make this private. That means no one can access it. So the whole purpose of making a private class is to support a class within the same file, right?
Yeah.
So for now, what I want you to approach is that classes needs to be public for our purpose, okay? But the data inside of it could be private, but our classes has to be public.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. For now, we're gonna change at some point, right? That's gonna change later. But for now, I don't want you to get confused.
Yeah.
Think of as like classes needs to be public, all right?
What do you mean, Pagoda? It means just this project or can you access the other projects?
No, it's everything within the project.
It means global.
Yeah. Well, global means within the project.
Within,
yeah. No. All of this work, when I say public or global or whatever, it's within only this project, Java Demo. But you can create a class called vehicle in another project and expect to access that. That's not the goal. All right? Okay. The next topic is, guys, sorry. We can cover that in a break. So getter and setters, that's the next topic. So getter and setters are used to effectively protect your data, particularly when creating classes for each variable. The get method returns its value, while the set method sets the value. So now we're going to be using set method to set the value, not directly calling the variable to set our values, right? So getter starts with get, followed by a variable name with the first letter of the variable name and capitalized whatever, setter the same way. So this is how it would look like. So if you go back to your vehicle, so let's say you have private string color, right? You'll have a getter and you will have a setter. If you need to set a value, if you need to set something, you're going to be calling a setter. And then if you need to get it, obviously, you're going to call getter. So let's create this. And then we'll use it here, okay? So there, let me just get rid of all of that. So the whole idea is to set the color and then maybe I want to get it at some point. And one of the examples I can give you guys is, let's just go into a real life scenario so that it's not confusing. Right, and then, so here, think of we are setting some dates. So we're going to Boston at 4:27 and coming back at 4:28, okay? And then I'll search. So we initially set some value, right, that we wanted to go. But look, I still get to see my data here, destination, and also, but I'm not setting anything here. What this is means, they're calling some sort of a get call. You set it initially, and I will keep tracking of that throughout my entire booking experience, for example, right? So same thing as like when you go into Amazon, you log in with your username, right? But your username is also on the top right corner. So because you're not setting it there, but you initially set it when you logged in. So think of that's a setter, right? When you logged in, we set it. As soon as you set it, I wanted to also display this throughout your entire experience in Amazon.com. Does that make sense? So you can initially set some data, I can keep it and then display it. So, but how do you display it, right? How do you read it? Using another method called get, right? So in this case, you could say set check-in, get check-in. Set check-in method will be called to set some data, and get check-in method will be called to display some data, same data. Does that make sense? Now, think about this. Can I display something without setting it? No, like it doesn't make sense, right? But you're going to do this coding a lot of time. You're trying to get something that you have never initialized it. You have never set it, right? So that's when you're going to start getting null point exceptions, right? That means, hey, this was never set, right? So you're trying to call something that doesn't exist. So make sure like you understand that part. So what we have to do is you can obviously manually create those getters and setter, but this you can also generate them. So you don't have to kind of, and if you have multiple methods here, you will have option to, I mean, multiple variables, you'll have list of all of them here. Let's just say you do this, and now you have your getter and setter available, right? Okay.
Magic.
We'll manually create them.
You set it and you got it.
Yeah, no, there is like a little, let's do it manually, right? No, I know. I'll prefer. Okay, everybody pause. You right click, you click on generate, right? And then you see where it says getter and setter. You select that, and then you select the variable that you want to get and set for. Okay? And that's it, right?
There is like a couple of variables we can select all of them,
yes,
or only one.
Yeah. Yeah, but now I also want to say not everything needs to have getter and setter. Sometimes maybe this variable does not need to be exposed. Maybe its scope is only within that class, right? In that case, why do I want to create another method to display it outside of this class? So it's only if you need to expose this variable data outside of this class, you need a getter and setter, okay? But let's just do manually so I can explain what's happening. So first thing, we need to create a method that returns whatever inside of a color variable, right? So let's say public, and when I use the word return, that means I need to have a return data type, right? But we are dealing with color. What data type is color? String. So therefore, we need to say, oh, the return type is going to be string, and we can name it getColor, and then finally use the return. And what are we returning here? Color, right? So whatever was set to color, now store into this method, right? So now we need another method that sets the color, where you can actually insert whatever the color that you choose, right? So we'll say public, and since we are setting something, we just want to perform an action. We are not returning anything here, right? So therefore, we can just say void set color, and we can say, but here's the thing, you need to have a local variable, and this is the bit confusing part of it, right? And I'll explain it. And I also named it color, but this is a global, this is a field variable, right? So it has a scope all over the class. This is a local variable which has a scope within only the setColor method. Make sense? But what we want to do is, whatever the user passes in here, because that's what the user will set, right? That data needs to be stored into this field variable. So we need to set this field variable to whatever data that is being received from a local variable. Confusing enough?
Yeah.
Right, so that's good. So what we're going to do is, so this dot color, right?
Local, yeah.
No, it doesn't. So this dot color means I'm referring it to
field
variable, right? Global variable equals to, I'll just say color. In that case, whatever that means it's a local variable. Though you might be saying, well, that makes no sense, Mohammed. Why don't you just name it C and then that solves all the problems, right? Because then there's no duplication problem. Because if you just use color now, then it's perfectly fine because there's only one instance of color on that entire class. There's no duplication, right? You can just say, oh, color does C. Well, that's not good coding standard. It will work, but that means you don't know what you're doing, right? So we need to make sure we follow all the coding standards going forward, right? When you look into someone's code base, you should automatically know what's going on, right? So try to understand this dot color means whatever the color that's going to be passed in here, I'll grab it and then set it back to this dot color. So when this method calls color, it has that color available to them. All right, so I'll delete this. So this keyword is, you know, pretty much used to refer a field variable, right? So if you have a same variable name between local and field, and if you want to differentiate them, just put the keyword this front of it, then the compiler will know that, okay, no, in this instance, he's referring to a field variable, right? But because if you have the same names, it's going to always, it's just like you setting it to yourself, right? So that doesn't make sense. And the whole purpose is to set it to the field variable so every method can access it, right? Otherwise, remember, this parameter has a scope only within this method. So even if this getColor wanted to access it, it can because it's kind of trapped within this method, right? So we need to make sure that we are using the right syntax so that everything gets cleared out. All right. Once our getter setter has been defined, we can use them in the main method. So let's try doing that. So we'll just delete this thing. But you see how we don't have access to those other ones now. So let's say if I do this, v1.getColor, what can I see? What would it print? You get something called null, right? Because we have never set the color. So it makes no sense to even print anything, right? So, but we will do that a lot of time. Like, no matter how many years you're working, you're always going to call something that you've never set, right? And so when you get a null for an exception, that means you're doing something wrong. You're calling something that you never have initialized, right? So we need to initialize it here, or we need to set it by saying v1.setColor, and we'll set it to, let's say, red. Right? Now if we run it, we should see red as our color, right? So that's kind of how getter and setter kind of works. So we can also store it into another variable. Let's say v1.getColor. So then you get to really see where the color is coming from, right? So if it has a return type, you can probably punch it in into system.out, but usually this is to use for logic purpose inside of an if logic or switch or loop or whatnot, right? But for now, all I want you to take away is that obviously all those access modifiers, right? The differences between private, public, protected, also figure out the this keyword and so forth, right?
If we store two or three colors.
Sorry?
If we store it two or three colors.
Two, three colors of what?
Wafer one, it's red. Wafer two, it's green.
Yeah, but that's separate instances. So you are storing it, but every vehicle has its own colors. So to answer your questions, so let's say we create another vehicle, right? You can name it V1 because you already have, right? So you're going to say V2. So it's totally new instance. So you can totally have a new color. We're never storing it at this stage. This is just a reference point, right? So what you're saying is, remember, this is a template. Soon as we use this template for V1, it's just being used for V1. We can use the same template for a V2 or another car and so forth and millions of cars, right? They're not necessarily storing what you're seeing here. It's in the memory. That's what all the work is being done, right? So if we do V2 equals to new vehicle, so V2 dot set color. Let's say you like yellow. And then... you're shaking your head, so I don't know what you're saying. And color V2 dot get color. So I can name it color because it's the same scope, right? In this case, I'll just say C. And then we'll just print out C. What do I expect to see? Can someone raise your hand? And you have to have an explanation behind it.
You're going to see yellow because you assigned V2, set color to yellow, so our vehicle number 2 is a string and its value is set to yellow. So you're going to see yellow.
Okay, I get to see yellow.
I'm going to see both of them.
Excellent, right? I'm going to say on why.
Because you're telling the system to print both.
Right, so it's kind of like creating two different variables, right? It's like, remember when we did a string name equals to string date equals to today. So you're just using the data. It's just kind of like the data points that you're using. You can use the same data type and same variables to do other things because, in theory, memory in Java has allocated some memory for name, right? And then it decided to use a string data type, and that's where it stored it. And then same thing with that. Again, they're both data types are same. It's still a string data type, but Java has a separate memory for date. And it's storing today there. Same thing with our vehicle. When we first created a vehicle, V1 was an allocated space somewhere in the memory, right? And it's only reserved for V1. And you can do whatever with that V1. It can have its own color, own wheels, own speed, and all of that, right? And then you created another instance. Java created another instance within the memory, which is only specific to V2, so it'll have its own specific color and all of those different other things. Does that make sense?
Yes.
All right, excellent. All right, next thing is, so getter and setter allow us to have control over the values. You may, for example, validate the given value in the setter before actually setting the value. So we can have setter for instance, password, right? Let's say someone is signing for password, right? We can have a value called password, and you can do all the condition within the setter, right? So if someone tried to enter invalid password, you can control that. Whereas if we didn't have the setter or getter, and if everyone had access to your variable, you had to write that logic 500 different times. So the one thing is, yes, protecting your data. Another thing is reusability, right? You want to keep the storage in one place. Also, another rule for coding is that if you're repeating something three times, you're doing something wrong, right? That means you should be creating a method that serves that purpose. Two times, that's fine, right? But three times, you should not be repeating something three times. So, for example, put me on spot, huh? All right, that's fine. So, let's say like something like set color, right? And I am creating this all over the place in the code base, right? So this would be a single instances. So let's say I have a set color method called here and some other class somewhere else, right? That means tomorrow, let's say something change around set color, then you have to change it in all three places. So we should have one central place and have a class to kind of access that through, right? And we'll get there into like, when we get into like object-oriented, like building out the applications, you'll see a lot of examples, and you'll also get feedback from these guys to not do it the same way, right? But most importantly, if you're repeating something over and over, that means, you should be writing a method for it, right? So like, think of like something again, validating password. And if your password object is being called 20 times, or let's say three times, right? And tomorrow logic has changed, you're going to update it in three different places, right? Whereas if you had it in one central place and you call that method on other two places, right? Then it's just convenient that way, okay? All right, so let's move on to, so getter and setter are fundamental building block for encapsulation, which we'll cover in later, okay? So encapsulation is a big concept, and it's kind of like an interview questions, and we'll cover that later. I don't know if I want to go over constructor today. I'll just keep constructor for later. So that one is a little weird to teach also. Let's take a quick break, and once we come back, we're gonna build a user, all right? We didn't record last half an hour.
Oh, wow. Your definition of fun and easy, we don't get it.
No, you go to a job, you'll be like, oh, this is what Mohammed taught. It's very childish stuff. But most importantly, guys, but anyhow, we still have time, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over the homework, but then again, refocus on this topic and make sure if you have any questions, so you can take a 10 minutes to write down if you have any questions, and if you and then we can address that in the smaller groups, okay? And Deepak, if you can kind of focus with the online group, maybe do a breakout room, and if they have any questions specific to you, answer that for them, right?
One question.
One second. I'll come around once you get there.
It's
because I told you not to do this one. This is coming from the IDE. Okay, so don't... The tool that you're using, it's helping you which type of method that you need to enter. You don't specify that. It's like a default thing, you know? All right. Guys, let's focus a little bit more. So what I want you to create, I want you to create a restaurant class with an attribute name, guest capacity, and guest count. So the whole goal of this is to tell me how many seats are available in the restaurants left. How many people are seated? Right, so let's say if it's 60 people, there's a seats for 60 people, right? 60 guests, and then someone calls, like let's say, I don't know, like 66 seats are occupied, right? and someone calls, say, hey, I have, do you have seats for 5 people? The software should be able to sell that, okay, there's no seats available, right? Right? So it's kind of similar to like any type of seating counts or whatever you want to find out, right? Availability, seating availability. So let's build that software, you know, over the homework. And so I want you to create a method that tells user if the seats are available or not. So someone walks into a restaurant and they say, okay, what is the party size? Based on the party size, or the host tells back, no, there's no seats available and whatnot. And then create a method that actually seats people. So now let's say another scenario where they come in, they say, hey, we have 4 people. Oh, we have first it checks if the seats are available. If it's yes, okay, let's sit them in. But then your original count needs to also decrement. Kind of like how we did the balance and income. Not exactly the same, but you have to play around with that. And then let's say someone finished their dinner, right? And they left, so now you have to also make those seats available again for you, right? So you have to remove the party and then make sure it goes back to the empty seat count. And then create a method that allows hosts to open for service by passing restaurant name. And that's kind of same thing what we did with user details. So you have to have a restaurant first, right? So when very first thing you want to call is that, okay, you know, set the restaurants or set the restaurant details. So you want to make sure you want to specify what is the restaurant's name and what is the capacity of that restaurant. That's important. How big the restaurant, how many seats are available for dining in that specific restaurant, right? And then create a method that prints the restaurant summary. So let's say a host wants to see how many people are seated or empty and whatnot, and that should pretty much tell you exactly what it is. So let's do one thing. So it should look like something like this, right? So you have a restaurant, you open for restaurant for service, you specify the name, and then restaurant capacity, right? And then you have another method, you want to sit, you sit the party, so you have restaurant capacity is 80, but you set 78 people, it must be a big crowd, right? And then you want to find out, is the seat available for 3 people? It shouldn't be, it should be no, right? It should be false. So you get a false, you should get a false statement here, and then you do a restaurant.remove party. So you removed 4 people, right? So now you have 74 people available at that point, right? And then you have another check if this the party size for 3 is available, right? And finally, you check your restaurant summary. So you want to kind of make it look like this. I'll share this with you. This should be your end product. Make sense?
Yeah.
Are we good?
Yeah. I have a question. Do you mind if you go over the thing that you recorded like for 5 minutes from the main?
Okay, we can go over it.
Because you know, like, in the class, I don't understand that much when I go home.
Okay, that's fine. No, that's okay. I'll just fast forward it. I wanted to assign more homework, but yeah. No, you can't tell from there. That's fine. It's...
same case.
All right, guys, I'm just going to review a few things just to go over it again.
Vicky has a question.
That's fine. Listen, guys, yes, that's the whole purpose. Can we just be a little bit, you know, quiet here so we can hear? And I think that will also clarify for a few people anyway. All right, so what we're doing here is we are creating a new user, right? A user class, right? So within the user class, you have a couple of few of attributes that represent, you know, that will pretty much make what a user is, right? So for instance, we have a name, we have an age, we have an income and expense here. And then we were asked to make sure if a user calls a method called DisplaySummary, right, we should give them some information regarding the user. So what we've decided to do is just kind of like a one full string with name, age, income, and expense. So what we are simply doing is we are passing whatever the value that is stored inside of these field variables are going to be displayed here. So if you had an income that was set to $1,000, it will print income 1,000. And if your name was John, it would be John. And whatever the age was, let's say 31, income 1,000, expense 40, right? Yes. So that's what you're going to see. But at a different time, it will be different value. So let's say if you reset that value, your income and your expense is going to be different, right? And then what we were asked to do is something called get account balance, right? So whenever you hear the word get, that means we need to probably return something, right? Mm-hmm. So what we are returning here is the account balance. So in this case, in income minus expense would pretty much give you what your balance is, right? Income is what's coming into your account, expense is what is going out, and that pretty much, if we can figure out what state is, pretty much what is coming in and what you kind of spend here.
After returning, we're not putting sign equal?
Where?
After return. Return?
No, we don't do return equal, because that you're not setting the value to return. Return is not a variable. Return is a data. Return is a keyword. Okay. Guys, let's focus. It's actually distracting when you talk in the background. And then you have set user details. So and then you're passing two parameters, because when we are setting user details, we need to pass in a name and an age in this instance, and we need to set those values to our field variables. So whatever the local variable the user inserts, we need to set it to our field variable. So this dot name equals to name, this dot age equals to age. All right? And then finally we have our, well, not finally, but the next one is set expense. So now we need to keep tally of expenses, right? So we are pretty much adding all of the expenses into one single variable. So whatever the value, every time user call this method, we're going to first get whatever the expense we have currently and add the new expense that a user entered. And one of the examples we went over is that, let's say in the morning you added an expense for Starbucks, which is $5, and then later for lunch you added a $20 lunch, right? So now total should be $25 instead of just $20. Should not be overriding it, it should be adding it. Same thing with income, no difference here. And then if you wanted to reset balance at any point, you will just say income equals to zero, expense, you're just hard coding the entire reset. Whatever the value is, we're going to be resetting it to zero. So it's just going to override your field variable to a zero. Okay? So that's kind of what, you know, just to summarize what we have done. And then if we were to run it, we come here. We create a new object for John, which is a user. John set the user details, because you need to set the user details. Otherwise, if you print out summary, it's going to say name null age zero, and then your income, and then you might be saying, well, why are you forcing them to use it? And that's what we're going to be learning in Constructor. Constructor will force you to enter required details before you can even create your object, similar to what you do with Scanner, right? And that's the next topic that we're going to be covering Monday. And then you set the income for John, and then you set the expense for John, and we set another expense to test our code, right? And then we finally, we can get the account balance here, and then you get the summary, we reset the balance, and we're getting a summary again, right? So if you run your code now, you should see a bunch of stuff. So this is your account balance that we've got here, and then you have your John age, name is John, age is 31, income is this. Then we reset it at some point, right? And then finally, you added that. You can add this to add more, maybe a better printout. So reset. So now if we run it, because when the reset happened, you didn't really know what was happening, right? So we can add more logs to find out. So, okay, reset success happened. And after the reset, you can do it. So you can do a lot of cool stuff with it. But at the same time, I just want to make sure, you know, you get how we are moving data from one side, one class to another class. That's very important that you understand. That makes sense?
This is exactly.
Yeah, it just create one class. See, we're learning how to mess around with one class now. So to our, hopefully by next Thursday, we can add three classes and four classes and five. So because it's like a spider web, right? So you just kind of have to create classes. Because you can't imagine an application where you only have users. You have users, you have accounts, you have investments, you have CDs, you have statements, right? So everything has to, you have to have a class that represents all of those things. And we're going to learn, we're going to actually build a bank application, so that's fine. But
do we have to use the
get? Well, we are using some form of get. What I want you to say, think is that I actually specify what the method name should be, I think. So you should be fine. But if you feel that you need to use a get somewhere, use get. If you feel you need to use a set, then use set. But my objective is at least solve the problem first and then optimize the code maybe, right? Okay. So just first solve the problem and then ask yourself, you know, does it look clean? Can I make it better? Can I simplify a little bit more, right? But just going simplifying, don't put everything into one method, right? And then put switch and put if else logic everywhere. Look, you're able to accomplish so much without any logic here, right? Just by method. Think about this. The more logic we put, that means we're probably not writing a very efficient code base, right? And that's why we call it object-oriented programming. I mean, there's a lot of new languages coming up. It's called functional programming. It's like you're not even allowed to write a logic. Like, your object should be smart enough to do a lot of different things, right? So, but before we get to functional programming, we gotta learn object-oriented programming, okay? But look, we literally build a restaurant without any logic here, right? So make sure you're doing this for restaurant piece of the homework, and if you can't get it right, work on Saturday, and then we'll review it on Monday. Is that homework sufficient or more? Good? Because I don't want more loop? Oh, no, no. We're done with loops. We're not really messing with arrays and loops just yet, right? For now, let's focus on the current task in hand, which is the objects, okay? But we can talk privately, all right?
I saw some exercise.
Yeah, that's fine. Any questions from online?
Yeah, Mohammed. So when you use like restaurant.eSit available and all those. So those are like additional methods which are not necessarily like a getter or setter, right?
Oh yeah. So you don't. Yeah. To answer your question, you don't always you don't always have getter and setter, right? It's optional. But you can also have additional method that you need. You're right.
Okay. And you said like by standard you should use like get and then followed by like any variable name, but we don't always tend to use a variable name because it depends on what we are
Depends,
yeah.
Right, we are really not like, if you look at my screen, right, I could say something like this you can say if John dot get account balance, right, greater than, I don't know, 5,000. We can purchase stuff. Does that make sense? So in this case, in this example, I'm just showing you to print it. We don't really, we are not writing another logic based on the value. Make sense?
Okay. So similarly, you're asking like, hey, if three people just came in, can we seat them in?
Yes. I need you to tell me, but you can get fancy with this, right? You can probably write a logic here saying, hey, if only seats available, then you can seat them. Otherwise, give them another message. Does that make sense? But
okay.
For now, let's first do the task the way I kind of did it. It's kind of mimics what I did, but it's just for restaurants. That's all.
Okay. All right.
Okay, then I'll see you Thursday, right?
Also, that for loop question, if you can answer.
Yeah, I'm going to look into a train.
Sure.
Let's see.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.